the day, I'm going to talk about two viewpoints on regular, coherent, and geometric logic. And I'm going to tell you what those things are, but I'm going to start with some... I didn't realize that I got the inspiration from someone, but I clearly did because I read his paper and then someone showed me that it is exactly the same thing. So someone named Evan Patterson... and this is Joy with Brendan. Evan Patterson said, or defined something he called relational O-logs. And in this world, you can say things like, works, and everyone who works has a salary, and everyone who works is a person, and everyone who works works at a company. And so that's the kind of, those are kind of some relational symbols that you write down, and then you can write things down like, well, if two people work at the same company, and I don't care what their salaries are, then I know, you could think implies here, that they're acquainted.
You might care that they're both persons.
They're both persons. And then, so he wrote down this, and he said that this is clearly coherent logic, and he wrote down kind of why. He didn't prove it was coherent logic, that this sort of thing is coherent logic, but he wrote down what coherent logic was, he wrote down what these kinds of symbols are, and these kinds of diagrams, and said it's clearly coherent logic. So you might want to...
So a quick question.
Yep.
Is that the definition of coherent
no.
logic?
No. Okay. We'll get to the definition. So. Okay. What we want to say, and I'll get to this later. Wow, this is a teaser. I don't know if it's an exciting teaser, but maybe it's a teaser. So if you had that, so I work, there's someone named David, and that's a person, and this person works at a company called Categorical Informatics, and I'm not going to tell you his salary, and suppose I say true is less than or equal to this diagram, and similarly that I know that what if I need the company to be small for it to be the case that if two people work at the same company, then they're acquainted. So now I know that CI is small. CI is a small company. And I know that, same thing for Ryan. Ryan works at CI. I work at Mathematics. I'm not going to tell you his salary. And that David and Ryan are people. So, are individuals. From that, you're supposed to conclude, be able to conclude that David and Ryan are acquainted. And that's the sort of thing you prove in coherent logic. So let me try to say what coherent, or regular, today we'll focus on regular logic, but let me try to translate this. So this one in logical formalism says that I have this says you take all of the variables, all the wires that don't come out, and you put existential statements on them. So you say there exists a company C, there exists a salary S1 and a salary S2, because those are wires that don't come out, such that works P1 C S1 and works P2, C, S2. If that's the case, then in the context of a person and another person, you can, and small C, you can conclude acquainted P1, P2. So this tells you the context. This is just a formula where you take all of the things in here and you equate and you write them together with ands, and you existentially quantify out all the variables that don't come out of this thing. So there's one, there's one, there's one, and you write this down. And over here, I would write things like true it, implies for any, true implies with no context that works, exists P colon person, C deceitful in company, such that that person is a type of David, and that company is a type of CI, and works. Oh, and a salary, sorry. Works PCS. I also need to say that David is an individual for this to be able to conclude that David works, that David and Ryan are acquainted. And what that says is basically that if I have two Davids, I forgot to write this, that's the same thing as having one David and splitting it. That these two are equal. That means having two Davids are actually the same David split. So we can convert these diagrams into logical things, or we could put them up here. We want to be able to work, we could work in either setting, and that's what this connection is about today. So regular logic, let me try to say what's going on. So we have regular logic, coherent logic, and geometric logic. These have like relation symbols, like works in and small. It has and it has exists. And you're allowed to form anything with ands and exists. Here you're allowed to add ors and false. You also have true there. And here you're allowed to add infinite ors. Okay, and the types of things you can say in regular logic, you can make theories, like the theory of groups. And so what you would do is you'd make a relation symbol called plus, or times, and you would say that you would have rules that say, like, times, a group element, you'd have one group, you'd have one type. Oh, all of these things have types also. So the types are like company, salary, person, they're what's on the strings. So I have one type called group, I have one relation symbol called times, and I have various axioms that say there exists a unit, there exists inverses, and stuff like that. And all those things would say things like, you know, it would be sequence you can write in this way. They would use and. So for group theory, you can do it all with and, exists, and true. Yeah. Oh. With coherent logic, you can say more stuff. You can say field, for example. You can't say field and group in regular logic, but you can say it in geometric and coherent logic. To say field, you need to say something at some point like field for all, well, sorry. I didn't think this through. True implies sequent for any x of my field. I have that either x equals 0 or x has an inverse, or exists y dot x y equals 1. And that sort of, that or is required, and so I need coherent logic. And in geometric logic, where I can do infinite ors, I can say things like torsion group, which says that for every element of this group, it is either it or it squared or it cubed or it to the fourth power is 1. So for different powers of theory, you need different powers of logic. And today I want to connect those to we're going to focus on regular, but I want to connect the kind of classical theory to the Wiring theoretic theory. And by the classical theory, I don't mean the logic. So it's, Evan Patterson said it's obvious that you can go between these two. What you would do for the coherent and for the geometric logic is you allow yourself to put ors inside the circles. So you can or up a bunch of things in each circle. He makes that pretty clear in his paper, and I'll let you go look at it there if you're interested in that. But today we're going to focus on regular. And so the connections are, we have like regular logic. We have
pictures, which are like, we're gonna make hypercategories, regular hypercategories. And we have classical regular categories. And this is the part I haven't told you about yet, but this part was done in the 60s, I think. This part is quote unquote obvious because the connection between both regular formulas and these pictures, regular sequence and these kind of, this side is less than or equal, this side is less than or equal, this side, those are sequence, and proofs are quote unquote obvious here. You take every wire and you might put an existential variable and all the context stuff I said before. This is the stuff that's left to us. So, and we'll talk about it today. How do we formalize these pictures as regular hypergraph categories, and how do we make the translation to regular categories, and what is a regular category? Okay, so here is the classical def of regular categories. So a regular category, is a category with finite limits image factorizations. What does this one say? This one says you have a terminal object and pullbacks. This one says if you have a map A to B, you can factor it as you can factor it as an image, which is a epimorphism, and this is a monomorphism, and anything else that A, if you have any map from A to some A prime and a monomorphism to B, then image is smaller than A prime. Image is the smallest monomorphism into B that A factors through, that this map factors through. So image factorizations and images are stable under pullback. So that says if you have any map from A to B and any map from C to B, and this is like an image, this is one of these image maps, which are often called regular epimorphisms, then if you find the pullback here, the pullback exists because we have finite limits, and this one is also an image map. This one's also what's called a regular epimorphism. But you can kind of look at this and say, maybe you don't like it as much. Like, it's not as pleasant I'm not trying to say this definition of regular category is bad. It's got a lot of advantages over this, and this has a lot of advantages over that. They both have advantages over the other, and the point is to show they're equivalent. So you can work here if that's more fun for you, and you can work here if that's more fun for you. And what's fun can change depending on the context. So we want to show that regular categories and these hypergraph categories are the same. So the theorem statement is for co-Cartesian operads. Okay, I'm going to unpack this later. For co-Cartesian operads, A, B, let this denote category of maps of co-Cartesian operad functors between them. Okay, so the theorem says this fancy picture here. So if you have a bunch of types called P, and you look at the Cartesian operad of cospans labeled by T, and their maps to meet semilattices, that is equivalent to regular categories. So this is the classical theory up here. I didn't tell you what a regular functor is, but it's things that preserve image factorizations and finite limits. And this thing is supposed to be the friendly pictures we have here. And this is the side I'll be unpacking. And then I'll show you the maps, phi and psi, that go between these two. Any questions so far? Oops. So the key idea in the proof, well, I don't know about the key idea in the proof, pretty much. One of the big ideas, I guess, or the small idea. So you might call this like the fundamental lemma of regular categories. For every morphism in a regular category, it goes like F taking C to D. The graph is a map C to C. We have C to C times D. What am I talking about? C times D. And there's a map there that's called identity comma F. And this is a mono. So this is a subobject. It's like a relation of C times D. So F is kind of like a relation symbol. If we were trying to translate between these two things, which you have to do to prove this theorem, you might want to be able to see morphisms as relation symbols. And the morphisms, the relations slash subobjects that arise this way, following are equivalent. TFAE. Following are equivalent for some R subset of C times D. One, it arises as the graph of a morphism. Two, if you have R and then R, but here you have CD and here you have DC. You have to label your wires. That this thing, that C is less than that, and vice versa. If you have R from D to C, because you can always turn these things around, you can always turn relations around. I mean, you can draw the picture a different way. So if I say this is less than or equal to this. And three, you can take R, and CD, and you, this is equal to C, and maybe I should give you intuition for these things, for what these are all saying. So this CDD is equal to this. Oops. RRDDC. So what this one says is, if you have two things, if you have C twice, actually, that's the same thing as a C that's sent by my function to D, and another C that's sent by my function to D. So this basically says total. What this says is every element of C hit some D under this relation. And this guy says deterministic. It says that if F of C is D and F of C is some other D prime, then
that D and the D prime are the same.